The first Sunday of the new year, of course. And we often say, well, we don't know what the new year holds. But that's not the point, is it? It's God who holds the new year, and we place our faith and our trust in him. So welcome. I don't know if you can imagine, but before Christmas, I was really, Lord, what is it that you want me to preach on my last three Sundays here at World Baptist Church? Can you appreciate that? That wasn't an easy answer to find. Okay, Lord, it could be this, it could be that. And it took me a while to feel that the Lord had led me to Genesis chapter 18. And in that chapter, there are three questions that I want to pose. One this week, one next Sunday, and then the Sunday after. And the first one is a question of belief. I've already heard it this morning. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Inviting us to consider the sheer greatness of our God. And next week, it's a question of friendship, where the Lord says, shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do? Indicating the closeness of God, that he desires this closeness with his people. And finally, a question of justice. Will not the judge of all the earth do right? So there are some very key questions here in Genesis chapter 18. And it's my prayer that looking at these questions, our understanding and vision of who our God is will be expanded and cause us to come before him with a greater sense of awe and of worship. So a question of belief. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Now, of course, the setting for this question was the Lord's appearance to Abram, as we've just heard, as he was sitting at the entrance to his tent. Don't think a small tent now, think almost like a marquee. Here, Abram was a wealthy man, and he had servants. So, you know, this was sort of no tent you could put up in the garden. Here was something that, you know, was a bit special. Three men appear, and Abram rushes to offer them hospitality. That was absolutely typical of the ancient Near Eastern culture, and it is still today, that hospitality is absolutely top of the list. And when strangers appeared, you offered them the best. So there's nothing unusual to provide three passing, wandering visitors some hospitality. So when did it begin to dawn on Abraham that these three visitors might not be ordinary visitors? Well, we cannot be sure when that happened exactly, but the statement recorded in verse 10 secured his full and complete attention. When one of them said, I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son. Can you imagine Abram suddenly looking up and staring at this man in the face? What is he on? Actually, that wasn't the first time that Abram, of course, had heard this. Let me take you back a chapter into Genesis chapter 17 and verses 15 to 19, and we read this. God also said to Abram, as for Sarah, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai, her name will be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her. Abram fell face down. He laughed to himself and said, will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? And Abram said to God, oh, if only Ishmael might live under your blessing. Then God said, yes, but your wife Sarah will bear you a son, and you will call him Isaac. And I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him. Now, we don't know how long there was between chapter 17 and chapter 18. It might have been months, or it might have been a few years. But whatever the length of time, I suspect that Abram often would scratch his head as he remembered what had been said to him. Did I really hear God say that? Here in chapter 18, it's Sarah's turn to laugh. Which makes me think, did Abram tell Sarah what he'd been told in chapter 17? Sarah laughed to herself as she thought, after I am worn out and my Lord is old, will I now have this pleasure? Just as Frank read it to us, in chapter 18. When God makes an impossible promise, how are we to take it? The question of verse 14 is indeed a challenge to believe, a challenge to have faith. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Now, the answer on paper is easy. If I were to give you sort of pen and paper and say you're all sitting in an exam and the question is anything too hard for the Lord, what would you answer that question? Well, you know what the correct answer is and you want to get full marks and say, no, nothing is too hard for the Lord. The answer on paper is easy. But can you put yourself in their shoes? Now, it's quite possible that Abram could have fathered a child even at his age. But Sarah? It was a biological fact that she had passed the point of no return. In the face of the impossible, God says this, just try me. Just try me. Don't know about you, but isn't it easier to trust God when we know that something is at least possible? It might be difficult, but it's possible. But then, if it then happens, we might then be tempted to think, and certainly the devil would put the thought in our head, ah, well, it would have happened anyway. You can't attribute that to God. Coincidences do happen. By the way, have you noticed if you stop praying, so do the coincidences? Yeah? It seems that in order to test and build up Abram's faith, God was actually waiting for the impossible situation. When there was no chance of, oh, well, it might have happened anyway, even if it was a 10,000 to 1 chance it might have happened. No, when it was impossible, it is then that God poses the question to Abraham. It's then that he poses it, not hypothetically, when the answer could be given off pat, but when the answer, well, it could be neither glib nor easy. Is anything too hard for the Lord, Abraham? He's in that situation, facing the impossible. God had promised something years before. Time had gone on, and they'd waited and waited and waited and waited, and nothing was happening. Abram decided to take things, well, Sarah as well, into their own hands. And so he has a son by Sarah's maidservant, Hagar. And so Ishmael is born. And so thinking, well, you know, Abram there giving God a helping hand with his promise. But that wasn't God's way. Sometimes we need to be aware of doing something that's not God's way just to get God's way, if you see what I mean. When the situation was absolutely, completely impossible, it is then a question of belief. Real belief. Real faith. The sort of faith that can please God. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Thinking of the similar fact that came to me yesterday, the story of Jehoshaphat. Actually, I thought it was Hezekiah. What do I know? So when I put into my computer Hezekiah, I didn't find the right answer. Oh, Jehoshaphat. You never stop learning, you know. It's Jehoshaphat, 2 Chronicles, chapter 20, verses 1 to 4 and 12. And the situation is that a great army is amassing around Jerusalem. The situation is, guess what? Impossible. After this, the Moabites and Ammonites, with some of the Ammonites, came to wage war against Jehoshaphat. Some people came and told Jehoshaphat, a vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the Dead Sea. It is already in Hazezon Tamar, that is En-Gedi. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. And then in verse 14, Jehoshaphat is in prayer, our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. It was done and dusted. Jerusalem was going to fall. That army could not be withstood. Jehoshaphat prays this. We do not know what to do. Ever been in that sort of situation? You don't know what to do. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. And as the story unfolds, so it turns out that these allies who'd come together to form this vast army that marched on Jerusalem, they fell out amongst themselves, turned on themselves, and they slaughtered each other. And when they left the walls of Jerusalem, this army that was so vast, it's gone, apart from the dead body. It was huge. We do not know what to do. Jehoshaphat, along with the people of Judah, will look into God. Help. The situation is impossible. God, we need your help. Now you can see where I thought about Lazarus this morning. You know the story. How he is sick, and the news comes to Jesus that he is sick, and Jesus stays where he is. He waits a few days. What? Not only is Lazarus dead, but he's been in the grave 4 days, and in sort of Jewish understanding, after that time, the spirit also has left the body completely. There is no hope of return. Dead and buried, big time. Did Jesus wait until the situation was impossibly impossible? He obviously did. And you can understand the sisters saying, Lord, if only you'd been here, and hear in their grief as something of a rebuke to Jesus. Why didn't you come earlier? But this was for the glory of God. This is for God to do what he specializes in, the impossible, in response to the faith and belief of his people. The World Baptist Church going forward, the people who believe God can do anything and trust him for. In this story, Sarah doesn't come out very well, does she? Laughing. We don't know when, but when we look at Hebrews, we discover actually Sarah herself believed. We read this. Hebrews 11, verses 11 to 12. By faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. Obviously, the people of the Middle East, the descendants of Abraham by Ishmael and Isaac, are in the new. Can I ask you to think, each one of those people is a result of this promise fulfilled to Abraham, who believed that God could do the impossible. In our prayers over the last few years, as we've thought about praying for Ukraine and now for Gaza, does not the situation look impossible to us? Yeah? Would we not stand with Jehoshaphat and say, oh, our God, we do not know what to do. This is too big for us. We haven't got the wisdom. We haven't got the resources. We don't know all the ins and outs, what people are plotting and doing behind the scenes, etc., etc., etc. We can lift that prayer to God in faith, saying, Lord, we don't know. Over to you. For you to do your thing. As I was thinking of this last week, I was reminded of when I was in Hyderabad in India back in 1987. That's another story. But I was in the home of an Indian pastor, and up on the wall there was this, what to me back in 1987 even seemed like a very old-fashioned black and white television set. And the news and the commentary was in Telugu, the local language. But I recognized the pictures, and I was awestruck. Because there, unfolding before my eyes, was the Berlin Wall coming down. That hadn't been prophesied in any astrological magazine or anything else. And how many of us would have said, next week, the Berlin Wall, but nah, don't be silly. Impossible. Can't happen. In our generation, in our lifetimes, impossible things have happened. You know, I get a bit cross every time I read about the evacuation of the British forces in World War II, Dunkirk and all of that. Because God has been airbrushed out of the situation. What happened to enable forces to be evacuated back across the channel was a miracle. That the weather allowed it to happen. And it's no mention in modern documentaries of the fact that before that, King George VI issued a call to prayer for the whole nation. It was a miracle. God still does things that are in the category of impossible. Are you facing what you consider and believe to be an impossible situation now, whether it might be in your family, in your job, whatever, whatever? And is God saying to you this morning, believe me, just trust me? No, I know you can't see your way out of this. No, I know you can't see how it's going to work out. And I know you don't see how I'm going to do it, but is anything too hard for me? Is the Lord this morning, millennia after he said it to Abraham, now saying it to you and to me as a living echo of those words recorded in Scripture? My child, listen up. Is anything too hard for me? One final story to remind you of is what we know as the rich young ruler. His story is in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And, you know, Jesus says, you know, a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Oh, that's tough. In fact, it's impossible. What said? I mean, because they thought, well, if you're rich, it's because you're under the blessing of God. So if the rich can't enter the kingdom of God, what hope for the poor? Jesus says, what is impossible with man is possible with God. And I leave that thought with you this morning. What is otherwise absolutely impossible is possible. One of the greatest impossibilities, of course, is to raise the dead. Scripture declares that all unbelievers are dead in their trespasses and sins. If you count yourself a Christian this morning, then you are a miracle, because God did the impossible with you when he brought you and me back to life. Yeah. There's no greater miracle than somebody's conversion. So if you're waiting, longing for someone to come to faith in God, and I know some of you are, this is also a word for you. Keep believing. Don't stop, for nothing is impossible with me. Let's pray together. We celebrate you, our God, as the God of the impossible, the God for whom absolutely nothing is too hard. Lord, forgive us when we doubt you. Forgive us when we pit our wisdom against yours. Forgive us when we pit our experience against yours. Forgive us when we pit our understanding against yours, as if our understanding, our wisdom, our experience is greater than yours. Perish the thought. Forgive us. And so fill us with that faith that once filled Abram and, we read, Sarah, who came to believe that nothing was too hard for God. If he has promised it, he will deliver it. So our God, with Jehoshaphat, whatever the situation we find ourselves in, our eyes are now upon you as we look to the future in this year and in all the years to come.